that that person who has not received it should receive it. Is that not logical and practical?
Whatever. I just think the people spoke and what they wanted, so that's the logic I follow. So, with the money we raise, we are fully funded to go to St. Louis, so that means that every single person that signed up, youth and adult, they pay nothing to go. So the kindness and generosity, close to 40 people. So we need you to now turn and focus your prayers towards our time in St. Louis. Pray that God is interceding ahead of time to make relationships and meetings that we get to have down there so that we can have some experiences with Jesus that a lot of these people maybe have never felt before. So thank you so much for that. So let's turn into our bulletins. We have a whole bunch of announcements that we can go through today. The gathering group will be doing a make and take wreath project on Monday, April 11th. So you have the information in there as well. And then you have your Holy Week schedule coming up. And then there's also an insert in your bulletin for Holy Week. So you have all of the stuff coming up this week. It's crazy that we're already there for Holy Week. So take your take these with you. So if you're ever wondering this week what's going on, you have all of those in there. Then you also have an insert for the Easter garden, and the information is on there. If you'd like to purchase flowers or a plant in memory of a loved one, you can do that. The form needs to be turned in by Wednesday, and then you can have those things here by Friday, April 15th. So the information is on here and in your bulletin. And then for seasoned citizens, Steve Nomlin, who is with Edward Jones, will be coming in. You have the insert in your bulletin there too, but I had a note that DeVern wanted me to pass along. He's going to be talking about inflation and the rising costs and how you can be comfortable during these times as well. So that is the announcements that we have for seasoned citizens coming up. The church office is going to be closed on Monday, April 18th for the Easter holiday. And then Camp Sunday is coming up on Sunday, April 24th. And take note, there's no Sunday school that day because we have the Camp Carnival. That'll be going on from 9:45 to 10:45. So if you have any questions about the Camp Carnival, you can see Christy, but we'd love to have a bunch of kids there. They can bring their friends and they can come and be a part of that. You have some very nice thank yous in your bulletin as well. And the dates for VBS are Sunday, July 17th through Thursday, July 21st. And as we're going through this, if you guys want to be filling out your Connect cards, you can drop those in the back on your way out. And then the last thing is we have an insert for the Find Your People study, and we also have a video that goes along with that. So if you guys want to turn your eyes up to the screen, we'll watch the video for that.
We all feel isolated right now. We smile, we nod, and honestly, it's killing us slowly, quietly. And we've lost deep, safe connections that God built us for. It's time for us to actually look underneath the question of what makes us lonely and why are we lonely, and to get free of it. Nothing in my relational life has helped me more than coming to terms with these three simple truths. You will disappoint me, I will disappoint you, and God will never disappoint us. You're gonna find friendships in places that you didn't expect. The friendships you already have, they're gonna deepen. I believe all of that. But they're all sinners, and so are you. And so this is gonna be messy. We have to stay. If we have people to do life with, we can't quit them and start over every time it gets hard. I'm praying this changes everything in your life, that you view your family differently, that you view your friendships and neighbors differently, that you see that every person around you has the potential to come into your life and to change it in small and big ways. No more living alone.
So you have the information in your bulletin for that as well, and if you'd like to sign up for that, you can let the office know. That is the end of our announcements. Why don't we stand and greet those that are around us this morning? Please join with me in our responsive call to worship. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Please remain standing for our opening hymn, Sweet, Sweet Spirit. Please join me in our unison opening prayer. Almighty God, on this day your Son, Jesus Christ, entered the holy city of Jerusalem and was proclaimed king by those who spread their garments and palm branches along his way. Let those branches be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may hail him as our Lord and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life. In his name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Would you please bow your heads this morning as we pray our prayers of celebration and care. Holy and wonderful God, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to be here today. We thank you for every face that's here, God, for everyone that's listening, for everyone that's watching, God. We just pray that you would bless each and every one of us. And we pray, Lord, as Pastor Thom brings a message today, God, that you would speak into his heart and give him a message to share with all of us, Lord, so that we can leave here changed people. And that when we leave here, Lord, we can see that everywhere we go is the mission field to spread your love and your care to all of those that are around us. God, we pray for our farmers and ranchers as they start to think about this springtime, Lord, as we start to calve and as we start to think towards field work, Lord. We just pray for your safety for all of those that have to be outside. We know, Lord, that there could be some weather coming this week. God, we pray that you would be with those that have to be out in it, Lord, and help us to stay safe through it. We pray for our teachers and our school children as they look to finish up the year. We pray, God, that you're with them, that you're helping them to finish strong. And Heavenly Father, as we look towards our prayer list today, we pray that you would be with Donna and the family and friends of Audrey, and for Harlan, and for Barb, and for Janae's aunt, and for Barb, and be with Floyd as he's back in the hospital again. Lord, we also pray that you're with the family and the friends of Ronnie Secchi. God, we pray for all of those that are hurting. We pray that you would be with them, Lord, that your spirit would be with them, that you would guide them and let them know that whatever is going on in their lives, God, that they don't face those problems alone, that they have you there with them, Lord. We pray for our trip to St. Louis this summer, God. We pray for a safe one. We pray for one, Lord, that we can meet Jesus in ways that we've never seen him before, and he'll become real to each and every one of us in ways that we've never got to experience him before. And God, we thank you for the generous hearts of those who are able to help us make that trip possible.
And Jesus, we pray for those beautiful children today as they wave the palm branches, God. Thank you for allowing us to be in a church where we get to see so many faces of those beautiful children, Jesus. We thank you for that. We pray all these things in the way that you taught us to pray. Sing, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would you please rise as we sing our next hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Please be seated. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Mark, the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 10. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who were following were shouting, "Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest." Here ends our reading this morning.
Before I invite the children up, you ready for this, Brad? So Brad DeBoer is sitting up here behind me with his family. He normally doesn't sit there. Have you guys heard this man sing before? Holy smokes, I heard he was a good singer. Man, I'm enjoying this. Thank you, I appreciate it. You guys should hear this guy. I think we need to try and convince him to do special music. Just put you, I can see it in your eyes. You're gonna get me back for this, aren't you? Yeah, I can see it. All right, I'd like to invite the children to come up for just a minute. Doing this morning?
Good.
I am very glad to hear that. So I have my keys with me this morning, and keys can be very important things, can't they?
Yes.
Because I have keys here for the church, I have keys for the house, I have the key for my pickup. Now, do you think I should just let anybody have my keys?
No.
Right. Yep. And so what if, let's just say, the President of the United States walked in and said, "Hey, I need to borrow your pickup. Should I give my keys to him?"
No.
I should say no? What if we had a different president? Okay, what about our governor? Say no, really? Okay, so I would probably, if the president walked in, I don't care who the president of the United States is, if they walked in and said, "Hey, I need your pickup, can I take your keys?" I would probably give them my keys, right? I mean, that would be the right thing to do. You're still not agreeing, are you? Yeah. But you'd think you'd be able to trust the president, right? Even if he were to wreck it or something, he'd probably buy me a new one, right? I would like to think that. Huh? He could buy his own. That's true.
And he already has one.
The president usually doesn't drive anymore until, I don't know if they ever drive again after they're president. But so what if Jesus were to ask me for my keys? Should I give them to Jesus?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So you trust Jesus. Very good. Very good. But do you think Jesus knows how to drive a car? Yeah, who knows? He might. I mean, he is God, right? So he might be able to just hop in a car and drive. I don't know. But what about this? If there was a parade going on and the president was coming through in the parade, would you be excited and clap and shout out?
Yes.
You got a couple yeses. Wow. I feel sorry for future elections that are going to happen when these kids get older. Oofta. So, what about if Jesus is coming through on a parade?
Yeah.
Would you shout and be excited?
Yeah.
Yes. Wouldn't you? I would too. You know, the scripture Levi read talked about Jesus coming into Jerusalem and people, you know, waving palm branches, putting their coats down on the ground for Jesus, and they're shouting out, "Hosanna, Hosanna," to Jesus. They were excited because here comes Jesus into Jerusalem. My question is this for you. When you think about those people lined up on the road shouting and being all excited, shouldn't we be doing that like every day? Right? Because of who Jesus is? Because through Jesus we get to go to heaven? Shouldn't we be shouting and excited every day we wake up because of that? I think so. And so that's what I'm going to ask you to do, is every morning when you wake up, I want you to, just for a brief moment even, just say, thank you, Jesus, and just, you know, really loud, okay? Wake up your mom and dad if they're still sleeping, okay? All right, let's pray. Loving God, Lord, we thank you for Jesus, and we pray that all these children will continue to grow in knowing him. And Lord, we pray that we can all celebrate him every day. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Okay, ladies first. There was a Presbyterian church, a Methodist church, and a Catholic church. All three of these churches were having problems with squirrels living inside their church buildings. One day, the Presbyterian church called a meeting to decide what to do about the squirrels. After prayerful consideration, they decided the squirrels were predestined to be there, and they shouldn't interfere with God's divine will and just let them be. The Methodist Church Council got together and decided that they were not in a position to harm any of God's creation. So they just humanely trapped all of the squirrels, took them out about 3 miles away from the church and let them go. And 3 days later, all the squirrels showed back up. And then there's the Catholic Church. They came up with the best idea, the most effective solution to take care of the squirrels. They decided to baptize all the squirrels and register them as members of the church. And now they only see them on Christmas and Easter. Here's the really bizarre thing, you guys. Most of you laughed, thought that was funny. Second service, they're gonna be booing me, I'm telling you. Just watch the service tomorrow. Yeah. Okay. So with a few very minor exceptions, all four gospel accounts of Jesus's triumphal entry into Jerusalem are very, very similar. Some of the exceptions are, like I said, trivial, small things for the most part. For example, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they use the word colt, where John uses the word donkey, right? Not a big deal. Also, Matthew, Mark, and Luke have the disciples getting the colt, where the Gospel of John has Jesus finding the donkey. One of the more interesting ones, though, is Luke doesn't even use the word Hosanna. The other three Gospels do. And the Gospel of Mark also has Jesus leaving Jerusalem after his triumphal entry, after he goes in and checks out the temple. He leaves Jerusalem and heads back to Bethany. And the other Gospels have him staying there. So some interesting things, nothing major that changes the storyline all that much, except for maybe Luke and his not using the word Hosanna. One of the more significant similarities, though, through these four Gospels, is that they all share 7 biblical prophetic statements from the Old Testament, the same ones. We have, for example, the Mount of Olives, Bethany, the location, right? And we can read about that in Zechariah 14. There's also the preparation or securing of the colt. And we hear about that in Genesis 49. There's the actual procession of Jesus on a colt, the cloaks being thrown down on the ground. We hear that in a number of places, Zechariah, 1 Kings, and 2 Kings. And then we have the people's response of joy found in Psalm 118 and Habakkuk 2. So all of these prophecies in the Old Testament are being fulfilled in Jesus' entry from the beginning to the entry into Jerusalem. So now imagine that you are lined up alongside the road. You know this prophetic passages, okay? You've been taught your entire life that God would send a Messiah, that he would send a Redeemer, that enter Jerusalem in a way that's been told to you time and time and time again. And now here's Jesus Christ riding in on that donkey slash colt, fulfilling those prophecies. You've been waiting for generations for this time. Now, you also know that whenever there was a new earthly king that would come into Jerusalem or into really any city, they would come in a very triumphant kind of way as well. That would also include all of those who had conquered Jerusalem in the past. They had come in with big fanfare and excitement. And also imagine that either you personally have experienced or maybe you heard about Jesus' authority. Maybe you saw or witnessed Jesus' incredible, powerful teaching, and maybe you even saw a miracle or two or heard about a miracle or two he's performed. Right? You're on the side of the road. You know the scriptures. You know what it's like when a king comes in to enter, to take over and rule. And you see this man that you've heard about fulfilling those prophecies, a man who has performed countless miracles, a man who has fulfilled prophecy after prophecy. And he's coming towards you along the roadway. The long-awaited Messiah is here. If you have any kind of imagination whatsoever, you can almost feel the excitement for the people. The sense of enthusiasm that is permeating the air. It was truly, you guys, an absolutely amazing and hope-filled moment for those people who were processing into the great city of Jerusalem, because here was this man who did teach with authority, a man who was sinless, a man who performed countless miracles, a man who fulfilled one prophecy after another, including the act of riding into town on a donkey slash colt. He was a man who had all the signs of the long-awaited Messiah. Those who gathered together that day, they had to have been overwhelmed with unspeakable joy and excitement. Jesus Christ, God's Son, is coming to rule. Now, in all of their excitement, when their emotions are skyrocketing out of control with joy, I seriously doubt, in fact, I couldn't find any commentator, anybody that would say this. I would seriously doubt that anyone could have ever imagined, except the 12 disciples, imagined that Jesus was going to be crucified. Jesus had told the disciples many times he'd be crucified. They struggled with it, and they went back and forth with it all the way up until almost the very last minute. I don't think those people who were shouting Hosanna that day could have ever predicted Jesus hanging lifeless on a cross. And I say that because their expectation was that the Messiah would save them from their oppression, the domination, the tyranny and control that they'd experienced for generation after generation by the Babylonians, by the Assyrians, by the Romans, etc. And this is why they're shouting out Hosanna. This is why they shouted out Save Us. They were shouting, save us, because they wanted the Messiah to save them from the control of worldly kings and worldly kingdoms. They wanted a Messiah that would bring them personal peace, health, and prosperity for their earthly lives. That's what they wanted. That's what they expected. They didn't see the Messiah as saving them from the bondage of sin and providing them eternal salvation through this humiliating, horrific, and very cruel death on a cross. A lot of people celebrated Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. And they did it with an incredible amount of excitement and hope, with enthusiasm. And I can't imagine how they must have felt later. They had to have been like completely on the other side of the scale, disappointed. Because what they thought they were getting and what they'd end up getting were two different things altogether. And what happens when we expect something and that expectation is not only not met, but we end up receiving something we really didn't want? We're disappointed, aren't we? We're very disappointed. Now, there have been people, and still are people to this day, who will metaphorically line up along the roads, praising Jesus while at the same time projecting their own wants and expectations onto him. And they don't end up seeing or witnessing or knowing the real Jesus Christ. So Jim Benedict, in Not What He Had in Mind, says this: a lot of us want Jesus to be a certain way. We want God to solve our problems as we perceive them, in the way we think is best. We want Jesus to be the champion of our causes, whatever they may be. We want God to take our side in every conflict, from family squabbles to international politics. And when things don't go our way, we are quick to conclude that God or Jesus has let us down. He goes on to say, but the Palm Sunday story should remind us that this is not how it works. Jesus will not simply step in to champion our causes any more than he had championed the cause of Jewish independence 2,000 years ago. Jesus on a donkey's back was a sign, and we ought to take heed. Jesus is not interested in our agenda. Jesus has his own agenda. Amen? There are people who will create their own image of Jesus. It's comfortable. It's easy. They want Jesus to be what they want because it's comfortable and secure. They want Jesus to be something that fits their needs, their desires, their wants. They expect a Messiah that will bring them personal peace, health, prosperity for their earthly lives. That's their expectations. But we all know that Jesus didn't come into this world to fulfill our expectations. And I tell you what, that is absolutely wonderful and great news, and I'm extremely thankful for that. In fact, I think it's safe to say that we should all be extremely happy that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey with the full intent of living up to the divine expectations that were placed on him. Because he followed through on those. And now each one of us, through a relationship in Jesus Christ, can confidently say that we are saved. As Christians today, we're fortunate, and I say this from time to time, I know it. We're fortunate because we have hindsight, right? And so we know the whole story. We have the knowledge that through God's grace, he came to us in the flesh as Jesus Christ to redeem us of our sins and provide us a means of salvation through that cross. We know that. The people of the time, as Jesus was coming in on that colt / donkey, they didn't know. And so now as we look toward Good Friday, as we look toward Easter Sunday, my hope is that we can do it with a sense of great appreciation, a celebration of praise, of hope, not just because of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem as it was prophesied about, but because of the grace that we receive in and through Jesus Christ, who will be hanging on a cross just days later. Amen. Let's bow our heads in prayer. God, we thank you that Jesus held to his divine call, that he wasn't swayed by Satan in the desert for 40 days, that he wasn't swayed by the people to stick around to be an earthly king. We're thankful that that he came to save us, not from the powers of this world, but to save us so that we may experience eternal salvation with you. Lord, bless us as we continue on this Lenten journey and as we move into Holy Week. Lord, we pray that we can continue to grow in our knowledge and love and relationship with your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray all this in his name. Amen. All right, let's stand and join in singing our hymn of response, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna, 278 in the hymnal, and up on the screen. If you feel inspired, you can go ahead and wave your palm branches, and as the children come in, you can wave your palm branches as well.
Thank you.
Please join with me in our unison offertory prayer. Blessed Lord, we surrender our lives to your message of salvation. You have given us the gift of unwavering love. Multiply these gifts so that we may share the magnitude of your joy-filled message throughout our community and world. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Amen. Please be seated. We'll now have our Sunday school children bring us some special music.
Thank you. Isn't battleground. I'm laying my weapons down. Hands up to heaven now. Make a joyful noise. My heart had to hit the floor to find all I'm longing for. But I know you're so much more than a joyful noise.
Love is a battleground. I'm laying my weapons down.
Before we conclude with a benediction, I just want to remind you that next Sunday, worship times are 7 a.m. for the sunrise service, 8:30 traditional, 10 o'clock for the blended service, okay? Now may God bless you, may God keep you, may God shine his light upon you, and may God give you his peace as you work out your relationship with Jesus Christ throughout this Lenten season. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.